Hi, Robbie Boone at Janet Davis Acoustic Music, and we're going to do a review today for you of all our used banjos that we have in stock. And I need to let you all know that today is September 16th, 2014, in case you're looking at this video in a week or a month or 3 months. The inventory that you see today may not be current, so if there's something you're interested in, give us a call to make sure that we still have it. But anyway, what the first banjo that I'm playing here, this is a Hayes arch top tension, kind of unique. You don't see very many of either anymore, and they've kind of taken the best of two old classics and combined them here. It's got a radius fretboard, has a neckville. I want to say tunnel, but they tell me this is not the correct terminology. But anyway, there's a slot that runs up the side of the neck here for this neckville fifth string capo. It's kind of cool, kind of unique. It's got a Fultz 1934 tailpiece on it that's kind of reminiscent to the old Prestos. It is a walnut banjo, burl walnut resonator, and it is flat, you know, kind of reverse of the old top tensions. The old top tensions were flat on the inside with a kind of a carved bevel on the outside, and this one's flat on the backside. And it appears to be a straight grain walnut neck. Just a pretty good banjo. Nice inlays in it. Nice work. But anyway, this is one of the banjos that we have on consignment. And if you'd like to visit about it, give us a call. This is another banjo that we've got on consignment here at Janet Davis Acoustic Music in Bentonville, Arkansas. This is a Gold Star GF200, and this is built along the lines of the 30s master tone banjos with a 20 hole flathead ring, one piece flange. Very Gibson-esque banjo. It is curly maple, neck and resonator, hearts and flowers inlay, clamshell tailpiece, and the banjo is just it's just really clean. It looks like it's been played really very little. And I think somebody has actually upgraded this armrest and this tailpiece. I believe it would have had a single leg plain armrest on it, and I believe it would have had a Repro Presto on it. So those are upgrades that the previous owner has added. But anyway, this is the Gold Star GF200, and give us just a minute and we'll review another one. Hi, this next banjo that we've got here, this is a cool old banjo, kind of a collector's piece. This is a GTR banjo from the 70s. Haven't made these to my knowledge since the mid 70s. And the GTR, the best I recollect, that's George Gruen, Tut Taylor, and Randy Wood. This is a mahogany banjo built similarly to a 70s RB250. Concentric rings in the back, two-piece flange, which was very common place at the time. Someone has upgraded this banjo with a engraved armrest and an engraved Presto tailpiece. Other than that, this banjo looks to be just pretty well. It's got an aftermarket bridge, but other than that, this banjo seems to be pretty original. I mean, really unmessed with banjo, and it wouldn't be very hard if a person wanted to find a correct clamshell and a correct armrest if you wanted to put it back to that 70s spec. But anyway, this is another one that we have here, GTR. Fiddle peg head, reef inlay, mahogany banjo. It's a nice one. And hang on, we'll review another one. Okay, this banjo that we have here for you, another unique instrument, very collectible piece. This is a Rich and Taylor J.D. Crowe model. And for all you banjo nerds out there, like me, you know that Rich and Taylor hasn't built a banjo in quite a while. And these were pretty scarce even when they were built. You just didn't see a whole lot of Rich and Taylor banjos. Really good quality banjo. This one is mahogany, built, I would say, in the flavor of a Style 3, probably trying to appease the J.D. Crowe people, you know, wanting a Style 3 style banjo. One-piece flange, 20-hole flathead ring, single-leg armrest, Presto tailpiece. I'm not sure what type of bridge this is. It looks like a good quality maple and ebony bridge. Rich and Taylor's inlay pattern, and it's my understanding, so don't chisel this in stone, but some of the patterns that they used, from what I understand, were some Gibson patterns that they did not use. So I'm not real sure what this is. It's really pretty, but it's a really, really nice banjo. And really collectible. If you're looking for an R&T, this is a good one to have. Like I said, it's a J.D. Crowe model. Haven't made them in several years. Grab this one up. Give us a minute and we'll get to another one. This next banjo that we've got here, similar to another banjo that we demoed a while ago. This one is also a top tension. Now, I mentioned that you don't hardly see many top tensions anymore, and it's kind of odd that we have two of them in stock. But this is a top tension flathead, and this is based around a pot assembly by Imperial, which I believe is Ty Piper in the Oklahoma City area. Don't know if Ty still builds banjos or not, but they were a really popular banjo in the 70s and stuff. I remember years and years ago, you used to see quite a lot of Imperial banjos. This one, somebody has upgraded it with a wood armrest, and it's over the top of a single leg metal armrest. It looks like it's got a Price straight line tailpiece on it. It has also been upgraded with a Neckville neck. Tom Neckville made this neck, and it says Neckville in it. It's done in the classic Gibson Flying Eagle pattern, though. Squashed frog or ghosts or whatever you want to call this pattern. It has four detuners on it. It also has one of Neckville's really slick slotted fifth string capos. Looks like a mahogany resonator with concentric rings, and I believe this neck is curly maple, and it's just a really nice banjo, nice custom banjo. Lots of upgrades done to this. Not sure what kind of tailpiece or what kind of bridge that is. Looks like something kind of goes on the space shuttle, but anyway, nice banjo, and we'll be back in just a minute with another banjo. Okay, we got another banjo here, and this is also a custom banjo. It says that it's a Frank Neat banjo, so I would say that this banjo started life as a Frank Neat custom built, which would emulate a 30s master tone. Beautiful, beautiful grained mahogany resonator with concentric rings and a mahogany neck. Now, I don't know if this is still the same Frank Neat neck. I mean, some things make me think it is, some things make me think it isn't. What I do know is it's had a radius fretboard added to it, and it has had a Neckville fifth string capo on the rail. This is like the third banjo that we've got in stock that's got this on. It's a really popular system. And instead of conventional binding up the neck, looks like when they put the radius fretboard on, they put a wood-checked binding on it, and we'll show a close-up of that later on. It's got a full tailpiece on it. It's got a one-leg armrest on it, one-piece flange, 20-hole flathead ring. And knowing Frank as I semi do, it's probably a Jimmy Cox rim, which is as good as you can get. It's probably got a Blaylock 20-hole ring in it. Once again, just about as good as you can get. So it's built with quality parts and just a pretty good banjo. And we'll be back in just a minute with another banjo. Okay, we got another cool banjo here. This is a Bischlein Custom, and custom, maybe not even big enough word for this. This one's really cool. Really flamed maple neck and resonator, and this thing has wood binding on it that looks to be also flamed maple. Looks like the neck and resonator themselves are stained, and then just a natural finish over the binding, which gives you the contrast. Really, really pretty banjo. Ebony tuning buttons on it. Very wreath inspired inlay pattern in it, similar to the old master tones. Once again, similar to the old master tones, it's a one piece flange flathead banjo, single leg armrest, and it also has a full tailpiece on it, and it's got a cat's eye bridge, cat's eye pinned bridge by Mike Smith, a good quality bridge. Just a great sounding, great looking custom banjo. And we'll be back in just a few minutes with another banjo. Okay, folks, this is the last banjo that we're going to review for you today. This is the last of our consignment of used instruments. And this one's really special. This is a 1926 Style 4 Gibson. It's a, what they call a ball bearing model. It's a two-piece flange, has the original two-piece one-leg armrest on it, has the original Presto still on it that is undrilled, which is really hard to find these days. Beautiful walnut, or excuse me, beautiful mahogany resonator. I'm thinking the wrong Style 4. This is an early 4. Mahogany resonator, concentric rings, has a really nice aftermarket neck on it, and we're unsure of the maker, but let me assure you that it is a high quality neck. Nice inlay work, you know, hearts and flowers, which would be correct for the time, has the correct white, black, white binding on the sides of the neck and the heel cap. Someone has paid, you know, quite a bit of attention to detail here. It has 4 Keith detuners on it. And with this instrument comes the original tenor neck and the 4 original tuners for it. If a person wanted to play it as a tenor, all he'd have to do is take this off and put the original tenor neck back on, and you'd be styling. It would be absolutely box stock. The only thing about this banjo that I have found that is not catalog correct, and I won't say that it didn't come from the factory this way, I will say that I have not seen one this way. 26 should have the quarter inch hex nuts to hold the resonator on. This one has later style thumb screws, which actually is a lot easier to deal with than the old hex screws if you're up on these old banjos. But that's the only thing about the banjo that I have seen that that is not catalog correct. And like, once again, let me you know, reiterate, I'm not saying it's not correct, it's just not catalog correct. Just a great banjo, really nice collector piece. To add to your collection of old pre-war Gibsons, or a very, very good piece to start a collection with your pre-war Gibsons. And like I say, I saved this one for last because these are near and dear to my heart. Also wanted to speak to the fact of playing. You're probably tired of hearing 5, 6, 8 versions of Little Girl of Mine in Tennessee, but I did that deliberately so that you could hear the difference in the tone and flavor of each banjo on the same tune. Sometimes different tunes show things that may or may not be there, so I wanted to give a fair comparison to all of these banjos. But anyway, if you're interested in this or any of these banjos that we've shown you today, give us a call or come by the store, and we'd love to talk to you about it. And anyway, y'all take care.